this seminar or session. And I don't know why, I was really hoping every time when we have a forum, we would like to see the, you know, the other side of the politics to come, so that we will have a better assessment on whose politics would bring Malaysia forward. But unfortunately, every time when I attend, you only see the opposition coming and not the government. But nevertheless, it's important for us to convey the message with or without them. I believe that talking on this point is, I think, across political boundaries, across political parties. It is more important for us to understand the issue at stake, as this will affect the nation, the survival of the nation. Although I think in most of the racial cases, there have been a lot of exaggeration. There have been a lot of exaggeration, exploitation, and taking the very risk of race issue. So I would like to give my peace of mind on this 15 minutes presentation about racial politics, and this is what we are discussing. And I will give you the bad news first, then I will give you the good news. It doesn't matter whether you give the good news first or the bad news, but what is important that we understand is not all that bad actually. There is still hope. Okay? There is still hope. Masih ada harapan. And that's what Amanah is all about. Giving up. Okay, this is a problem with the politician. They always, you know, try to put in their whatever ideology they have. Okay. Relating to the differences between races. This is what racial is all about. Okay? Relating to the differences between races. And you identify and you categorize people based on their racial background, based on their physical appearance. And this is racial, what is racial is all about. But let me give you one point here about the degree of racial politics. In a sense that, first of all, the most dangerous racial politics is when it is based on ideology, when that becomes your very core existence. A political party, for example, whenever they are based on race, ideology, this is the danger in it. Because they are doing it with conscience. They are doing it with awareness. Okay, so that is why I think this will come to the end when I will suggest on the way forward. Racial based on ideology, you can find in every part of the world where their political underpinning actually lies under the racial philosophy, racial ideology, and that translates into their political activities and policies. There's another point we need to know when we relate to the differences of between races, is that they are also racial based in political actions. So in other words, they are not really racist, but their political action moving towards that, not because they believe in it, but because they want to use their political action for their political interests. Okay? Although this is dangerous, but not as dangerous as the first one, which is actually based on ideology. Now if you look into the Barisan Nasional, for example, you might say, yes, they are based on racial-based ideology. But you ask anybody who's a national component, whether they are from MCA, MIC, or even AMANAH, they do not admit that they are racist. They believe in inclusivity. That's why they have Barisan National. But then again, it contradicts to their political actions. It contradicts to their political rhetorics. Why they are doing this? Not because they believe in it. So they had to do it for their political interest and for their constituent. And this is something to ponder about. You know, if you look into the Barisan Nasional, for example, you might say, yes, they are based on racial-based ideology.
But you ask any Barisan Nasional component, whether they are from MCA, MIC, or even UMNO, they do not admit that they are racist. They believe in inclusivity. That's why they have Barisan Nasional. But then again, it contradicts to their political actions. It contradicts to their political rhetorics. Why they are doing this? Not because they believe in it, but because they had to do it for their political interests and for their constituent. And this is something to ponder about. Another one is racial based on non-ideological. Well, this has got nothing to do with ideology. It's got nothing to do with any political motivation. It just, you know, when a Malay and a non-Malay, for example, Chinese or Indian, when they converse sometimes, they would get engaged into some racial jokes, for example. They didn't mean it. Or they just turned that into something of a humor, for example. Now, you cannot, simplify things that whenever one speaks of race in its language, that you are saying you are racist. This is an everyday, ordinary conversation between Malaysians, although this is not good. But then again, we do find that a lot in our society. Then you have the racial policies. If you look into the Malaysian context, you will find that the Bumi Putra 30% allocation is sometimes defined as racial bias. But then again, you must understand that there's this another term, what they call the positive discrimination. You know? Well, it really exists. There are positive discrimination in a sense that when you discriminate someone for a certain post and you have to be specified that only this guy or from such race or from such religion is appropriate for such post, then this is not racial discrimination. This is something that is attributed to certain race. For example, if an imam were to be appointed, okay, I can't say, why don't you appoint me, say a Christian or a Buddhist, say, why can't you appoint me, this is discrimination. No, this is attributed to such position which is given to the Muslim. The same thing to the priest, for example. So all this you must understand, there are terms which we call the positive discrimination. I thought my time was up. I didn't see any play card there. That play card say what? 5 minutes, huh? Not where is 2.6 billion, huh? Because it would be uncivilized for me to do such thing. Bumi Putra, for example, Hak Keistimewaan Bumi Putra. Yeah? Hak Keistimewaan Bumi Putra, which is stipulated in the Federal Constitution. That has been a great debate, even in our NUCC. Prof, huh? We discuss a lot of deal in this, whether do we want to do away with Hak Keistimewaan Bumi Putra, which is stipulated in the Federal Constitution. Is it the problem of such article? Or is it the exploitation by certain political parties using that article? So it needs quite a brave and a political will for us to actually, if we wanted to abolish such a privilege to the Bumi Putra. Racial phenomenon. Now, the phenomena that we're facing today in our society will refer to something like this. Look, I got 11 A's, why don't I get the scholarship? Okay? And this guy got eight A's, but he got the scholarship. Has been a long debate about preferences, has been a long debate about meritocracy, has been a long debate about whether these eight A's come from a family who has sufficient facilities for education, or the 11 A's who have better facilities for education. Is it coming from the rural area, or is it coming from the urban? So these are all issues that can be considered as phenomena, and it has been debated by politicians, especially in the parliament, and also outside. So these are the phenomena we are facing, and as far as racial politics is concerned, social interaction is very important today. Everyone I meet will tell me that it was not like 30 years ago when we were in school. We used to mix around, there was no problem, a Malay mixing around with a Chinese and China. But now, things are getting worse. By right, it should be getting better with all the policies that comes in. We should be more integrated. But the fact of the matter is that we are disintegrated. And you will see now, even my child in school, when I ask them, do you have any Chinese friend? They say, no. Do you have any Indian friend? No. You mix around with them and go out to have a lepak together? No, I never had a chance to go with my Chinese friend. I mean, it was so strange for me to hear such thing. Because when I was in their age, we were going around, lepak, watching movies, with our other friends, the Chinese, and then there was no such problem as food, for example. There was no such problem, even respecting the duties of a Muslim or respecting the duties of a Hindu or a Christian. But why is it today it has become a phenomenon? Why is it today that we are disintegrated? So this is a question to be pondered. Media, social media is the worst thing that could affect all what we are talking about. Today, the influence is all on social media. You find something about the Red Shirt rally, all this rhetoric about, you know, about anti-Chinese, words and symbols that they use, and discussing it openly in the social media, which I would think previously there was no such room for them to do so. Today there was this big social media room and space where they can, you know, just with just one WhatsApp, I think thousands of people can easily get access to whatever they say. And this is, I think, if not controlled, it will be a big problem for us to move forward. Now, I can't stop people tweeting, can I? I can't stop people doing WhatsApp, can I? But I can stop them by culturizing them. I can stop them by educating them. I can stop them now. If you have to tweet, tweet something nice. If you have to WhatsApp something nice. If you have to say something you feel, say something nice that could unite the people, for example. But that is a long process, actually. It comes together with education and culturization. We have another problem, phenomena, political actors and civil societies. Yeah, we are political actors. Me, my senior mentor, Mr. Lim Kit Siang, and my good friend, my comrade. We are political actors. But you don't have to play with the music. You have to take a strong stand. That no racial politics. Even though I know it will not benefit me, but then you have to make a choice. Whether you want to be popular, or you want the country to move forward. So, I will talk at the very end of my presentation. How many more minutes do we have?
6 minutes.
6 minutes. Civil society also play an important role. The NGOs. You have the NGOs who call for unity. You have NGOs who believe that their rights to exist calls for some ideology that they think is the best for the country. You have something like ISMA. You have something like Perkasa, for example. No? They are civil society, yes. But how can we stop them and say, no, you cannot, because you are a racial organization. I believe more in engaging. I believe more in talking. I believe more in telling them, educating them, what is good for the nation, what is not good for the nation. I think we have to come with a approach of engaging, dialoguing with them, and giving them where is the principle that every civil society can agree upon. Where are the principles that all political parties can agree upon? So this is a very difficult task, because Malaysian politics is highly ideologized, highly ideological. You know, it sometimes deprives us to see the most important thing about the nation first. And you have to come up with a politician to say that, look, nation first before your party. You have to educate politicians who say that there are so many politicians around, but there are no statesmen around. As I always say, a politician thinks of the next election, a statesman thinks of the next generation. So enough politicians, more statesmen. And I will come back to that in my conclusion. Reform and way forward. Yeah, this is what I meant. There should be a law reform and policies reform. Why not? You have to reform the law, which hinders the way and forward for unity. You have to come up, I mean, we came up with NUCC, with Professor, with Haji Hainun, my sister here. We came up with the law, Mr. Ho, from IKLIN, we came up with the law of what we call the National Harmony Bill, Akta Keharmonian Nasional. It took 2 years, not just to substantiate it, but also to go around and consult the concerned parties. And we believe that this National Harmony Bill, which is actually maybe quite similarly the same as the Racial Relations Act that you have in Britain in 1974, which was already enacted in 1974. And we think that it was so good, we need to bring a new law forward so that when you talk about racial hatred, you're talking about something that needs to be deliberated on what it means by hatred. And the most important thing is to punish those who propagate and instigate racial hatred, religious hatred, which is plaguing the country today. It was so good that we brought it around the country and showed it to the people, but at the end of the day, the most powerful man in the nation today said, no, we will maintain the Akta Hasutan, which the implication is we do not want any racial harmony act. They might want it, but they might injustice to their whips and their wives, which is wrong. You must have a strong political will to reform whatever you think is right. Because it's not whatever you think and your party think is right, you should think about what the people think is right. Interreligious dialogue, which I've been doing all this while, political parties reform. We must reject any political party in the future that is racial based. That is the only way for us to stop racism. If we still give them way, then racism will still exist. Because they are the political actors and the determinators of our policies and laws. Facts on the prospect of new politics and end of racial politics.
This is the good news that I was talking about.
73.4% wants a party that concerns every race. Actually, based on the polls done by Merdeka Center, 73.4% wants a party that concerns every race. In other words, they don't want racial politics. Number two, 67.5% Malay, 91.5% Chinese, 89.2% Indian, which concludes 76.9% preferred party that is inclusive. And Alhamdulillah, grace to God, AMANAH, its tagline is inclusivity. Because we know that is the way forward in the future. 70% of Malay do not support Bersefor, unfortunately. And nor do they support the red shirt, 53%. Because their issues is not about red shirt or about the Bersih really. Their issues is about livelihood. Their issues is about employment. Their issues is about high cost of living. Their issues is about GST. That is their main concern, not much of a racial base issue. Then you have this to understand what is actually happening in the Malay and the Chinese and the Indian. The Malay, 60% identify themselves as a Muslim, first. 27% identify themselves as Malaysian, whereby 6% only imply themselves or define themselves as Malay. There is good and bad in here. We will have time, we will discuss about it. Chinese say 60% identify on their faith. Whether they are Buddhist, whether they are Christian, they want to identify themselves as far as faith is concerned, only 60%. Indian, 3% identify on their faith, 63% identify themselves as Malaysian, 11% as Indian. Now, if you look into this figure, you will say that there is a hope that this country can move forward to end racial politics. Thank you very much. Assalamualaikum.
A lot of non-Malays actually cannot understand why is there anxiety. Kenapa orang Melayu takut, you know, that they will be left behind. If you look at the statistics like this, that, you know, civil service, 90%, including the top posts, are all held by Malays. The army and the police, more than 90%. Even the GLCs, our GLCs control about 25% of the GDP. Take all the GLCs, Maybank, Petronas, Sime Dabi, you know, and also the constitutional safeguard.
Regarding the special
rights of Malays and
Islam.
Not looking too well. You know, so I think a lot of non-Malays find it difficult to understand. Why, you know, why do Malays feel anxious? Why do
they feel threatened?
Yeah. Okay, why they feel threatened, you know. But there is an economic basis for this, you know. If you look a bit further, see, I did a study in the last few months between parliament sessions. I did a study of Malay families in rural areas in Sungai Siput, went to the kampongs and did a survey. Surveyed only about 130 families. But what I found was about 45% of these Malay families in Sungai Siput have a monthly household income of less than 1,002. 45%. And another 40% is between 1,002 and 2,000. So only 15% of them are more than 2,000. So actually poverty, you know, low income and poverty is a huge problem in Sungai Siput today, this year. And this is a reality that many Malays, rural areas face. I mean, our Prime Minister says we have already solved poverty, because they put a poverty line about 840 or something per family, you know, for a month, which is ridiculous. And even in Sungai Siput, 2,000 a month, not enough. You can't send your children for tuition, for example. You know, some of these families can't pay their electricity bill and get their electric supply cut. They come and see me then for some money. You know, so this is the way they're living at, you see. Among these, the families I interviewed, about 90% of the rubber smallholders are tapping less than 3 acres. And with the price of the cup lumps being only about 180, 190 a kg now, they make less than $600 a month, you know. And some of them have to, what they call bagi dua, because they're tapping on someone else's land. Okay? And 65% of these men between the age of 30 and 50 are not getting EPF. There's no social protection. No EPF, no so-so. So long term, what's going to happen to them? This is the reality on the ground, you know. So when you talk about Malay insecurity, that NEP is going to be removed, there's going to be a level playing field, there is an economic basis for it. Because they've, you know, they haven't yet come up. Despite NEP for so many years, you still have this problem. So Malay poverty is a reality still in Malaysia today. If you take the B40, yeah? B40 is the 40% of the poorest families in Malaysia. About 3/4 of them are Malays. That's a fact. So that's why, you know, it's important for us to understand, you know, when Malays don't support Bersih 4, what's the reason for it? Is it because they see with the Pakatan, you're going to do away with NEP and going to cut down NEP and what's going to happen to their children, you know? But there's a reason, is it? There is this reason, and I think, okay, I'll talk to that later. Now, this is something, a question asked by one UMNO MP in Parliament 2013. And he asked, what are the private houses bought in Malaysia? And these are the figures. Units bought by Bumi Putra, 99,000 for that year of 2012. Bukan Bumi Putra is 147,000. So much, there's more bought by non-Malays. Non-Malays make up less of the population than Malays, right? But you go down to the nilai also, you can see. The Bumi units are 36.3% of the units, but the value of these units is only 26.1% of the total value. What does this mean? This means on the average, Malay families are buying the lower end houses and the non-Malay families are buying the higher end houses. Okay, can see that, huh? This is industrial premises that were purchased in 2012. Bumi units only 237, 2.4%. Bukan Bumi is 4,200. Premises. This is, we're talking of SMEs. You know, if you look at the figures, 2.4%, 42.1%. There's another 50% that's bought by companies which are not racially. But that means the SMEs, the small and medium enterprises, very, very much more non-Malay. Malays are very small. Yeah. So this actually gives us a picture of the economy. You know, if you look at Malay improvement from independence. Okay, the civil service has been taken over. Last time it was mainly, you know, the colonialists, the British, plus non-Malays, but that's been taken over. It's largely Malayized, you know, a lot of Malays are there, DG positions, KSUs and all that. If you look at the GLCs, yes, that's been taken over. But look at the industrial level, business, the middle level of the economy, where actually it's very important for the higher income families, that you can see is still not yet controlled by Malays. I mean, the participation is quite low. Okay. So I think we have to move forward. See, race is real. Race exists. So how are we going to deal with some of these issues? Like the whole issue of affirmative action. Are we going to say enough of affirmative action, let everyone go in on merit? Is that something which is viable? What about, you know, the Malays in Sungai Siput who are left behind in other areas as well? So I think we got to think of the whole issue of affirmative action. I mean, it's easy. I think as far as B40 goes, you can say affirmative action based on economic need. Okay, that's, I think, can be settled. That people are talking about that. So since Malays and other Bumiputras make up a larger percentage of the B40, they'll get more of the affirmative action, special programs and all that. How do you address SMEs? How do you get Malay participation as SMEs? That's a bit more difficult, isn't it? If you don't target it racially, how do you target it? You can target the poor Malays in the B40 by socioeconomic criteria, because that'll catch the majority of them. But how do you target SMEs? This is something that we've got to talk about. You know, we have all these vendor programs, we have all these tekun loans, which I suspect are not really reaching the target. People are more happy getting the money and using it up and not really using it to develop their skills. We've really got to see how to do that, you know. So if we don't take these issues on and see how to handle it, then we shouldn't be too surprised when the Malay population doesn't vote Pakatan Raya, or it doesn't come out for Bersih 4, and we're stuck with this government we have. Yeah. And the whole issue of Article 153, you know, I think at this point in time, if there's any attempt to question that, you're going to just make poorer Malays anxious about the future. You know, so is it necessary to even talk about it or challenge it at this point in time? The SME sector, I already mentioned that. The other issue I think is interesting that Mujahid just showed you, that Malays identify themselves as Muslims first. So I think the whole issue of Islamization is something that we all have got to consider. Because that is something that I think is very real for the whole Muslim world, from the Middle East, from Morocco, Tunisia to here. It is on the agenda. And we have to discuss this. We have to put this on the table and discuss it. And I think, you know, in a democratic society, the only way to solve this problem is if we are open about it. I think we cannot say that I will not talk to you if you want to talk about hudud. We can't. In a democratic society, you have a right to bring hudud forward. If you believe in it, you have a right. And I think we've got, non-Malays got to say, okay, you have a right to speak about hudud. But at the same time, I have a right to say, why am I so anxious about hudud? What makes me worried about hudud? And in that dialogue, maybe we can move forward, you see. But I think it's something, again, Islam is Islamization of society, you know, of this is something that is there in society, not go away, you know. But the question is, what kind of Islamization, you know? Because there's so many good values, universal values, you know, of justice, of concern for the poor, you know, of proper governance, which is, I think, acceptable, is there in all religions, is universal values, you know. So is there some landing ground we can find, some commonality we can find? Okay. Now the thing is, how do we move forward on building racial harmony? Yeah? And I think having a shrill complaining attitude, they say, oh, I'm an Indian, look, so many Indians are poor, so many Indians are in jail, and you know, and I just talk about Indians, and the Chinese talks about Chinese, and the Malay talks about Malays, and we each complain and say, you did this, I didn't do this, and all that, it's not going to solve the problem. You know, I think we got to have much more empathy. You know, Indian politicians should be thinking of his whole constituency, which is actually, I've got more Malays in my constituency than Indians. I've got Orang Asli in my constituency. I think we've got to start thinking as Malaysians and thinking for the other community as well. Instead of, you know, only talking about your own constituency or your own race. So I think there's got to be empathy. I think all the people who are active have got to have empathy for other races as well, you know. So there's got to be reaching out, there's got to be respect, you know. That's the only way forward. I think we cannot be talking from the culture of I've been wronged, I have been done in, I haven't got this chance, I haven't got scholarships, you know. And going from that point, then everyone has got examples and has got experiences to say they've been wronged. So I think we've got to reach across that. Another issue is, are political parties part of the solution? Or are they part of the problem? You know? And I think we as ordinary Malaysians must tackle our political parties. Because the problem is our political parties have a particular vote bank. It's either a Malay Muslim vote bank or as a non-Malay urban vote bank. And sometimes they play to the grandstand. They play to get the votes of their vote bank. That's the reality. Whether it's opposition or it's BN, they both do that. And I think as Malaysians, you say, look, we want you to hold a higher standard than that. We don't want you to play race or religion. And we should go there, you know. Because it's only when they play this game and they get your support, they play the game some more. Because they know it works. You know? But if Malays and Indians and China, then I think they also being politicians, if they didn't get votes for them, they won't do it. So I think we have a role here, you know, in moderating how political parties also work. Yeah, I've come to the end of the thing. I think I'll echo what Mujahid said. There is hope. I think despite everything, you know, the NEP has made Malaysia more stable. That's all. Lau Yat didn't flare up any further. I think because there's a fairly large Malay middle class, there's a Malay elite class, you know, I think, to be fair to the NEP, I think it's made Malaysia more stable racially. You know, it's brought a lot of Malays into tertiary education. They can think for themselves now. And the country, okay, in some ways true, our kids don't play with other kids. There's more segregation at school level. But in other ways, I think we are more stable. You know, and I think there is hope that we can move forward on this. So thank you.
Saudara-saudara dan saudari, selamat petang dan salam sejahtera. I seem to be a bit more freer with the Komas as a result of my recent trials and travails. I think that Mujahid and Dr. Michael has presented their perspectives, and I would like to share with you some of my thoughts on this subject from current developments in particular. I think what we read in the last few days show that we are in uncharted waters, particularly in the UMNO, which is the major practitioner and as the incumbent backbone of the incumbent governor coalition. In particular, with the startling statement by Nazri declaring his support for Zahid as the next prime minister if Najib steps down. I think that shows that the undercurrents for a power struggle in the UMNO is reaching a new height. And in particular, the statement by Abdul Rahman Dahlan painting a very rosy picture that the UMNO PN will be in power for the next 2 years, and even after the 14G, the UMNO PN will continue to be governed, of course, basically to assure the ground and the public that there will not be a change of power, not only in the next two years, but also after the next GE. And I think this is particularly important in the from the point of view of the shape and the future of Malaysian politics, whether it's going to be continuing to be stuck in the mold of racial politics, or whether we can move forward to politics going beyond, less grounded on race, on religion, which is critical. And of course, we are going to go through various tests. Whether they're going to succeed or not, only time will tell. Whether there's going to be a vote of no confidence. And November the 16th is going to be an important date, because it will be the day that the budget will be voted on in 18 days' time. Although the prospects of the budget being defeated are not great, but nonetheless, this is the first time in the history of the nation that the possibility, the question of whether the budget will be voted out, whether there will be a vote of no confidence, became real issues for the country and the future of UMNO. There is no doubt that the question, if UMNO, if there's going to be a new prime minister, so to say, before the 14 GE, it had to be across the board. There had to be some form of cooperation between those in government and those outside government. Whether there could be an occasion for a new politics in Malaysia, going not completely eradication of the politics of race, but moving beyond politics of race to be more transcending questions of race and religion. I think these are very, very, very trying times. It is, we are in the uncharted territory. We don't know what's going to happen, and it is still to be seen. Because there is no doubt, I think, I don't believe, for instance, that although Najib may have got the support of 300 in UMNO, who are Supreme Council members and who are responsible for the various divisions, the UMNO chieftains, so to say, I do not think that he can be assured of the support of the 3 million UMNO members. And that's why I think all these dynamic forces are at work. But there is no doubt that what happened in the recent months have shown that Malaysia has become more polarized. Whether the red shirts rally of September the 16th, which is clearly was an expression of racial politics, was claimed to be a counter to the Bersih 4 rally. And of course, the Bersih 4 rally, although it was predominated by non-Malays, comparatively with lesser Malay participation as compared to Bersih 1, 2 and 3, it was nonetheless a non-racial, a multiracial manifestation. I can still remember that when I visited the Bersih and went around, and there were a lot of especially among the Chinese and the non-Malays, there was a consciousness among them of insufficient, especially on the first day, of insufficient participation of the Malays. So it was not a anti-Malay, a challenge to the authority of to the political power, but it was a conscious effort of Malaysians coming together, transcending race. So how do we move forward from politics of race to a more Malaysian form of politics? I think this is a challenge to all, not only the political players, but also to the Malaysians as a whole. And I think this will require in the coming years all political parties and all Malaysians to be more conscious of their role as Malaysians, rather than just as of race or their primordial affinities. That will mean, for instance, that the political parties will have to reach out, to educate, to make, for instance, the Chinese, the Indians, the more conscious that of their Malaysian perspective. In the same way that the Malays must be more educated or brought to realize that the whole worldview must not be just Malay or Muslim, it must be Malaysian. it is a conscious effort which must be made by all political parties. That I mean, the DAP, we have our strength among the non-Malay areas, but we must educate, as far as the DAP is concerned, that our ground, that as far as Malaysia is concerned, no single party, no single political party, or single political party, no single race can be able to rule this country. It must be a transcending, overarching approach. This is not going to be easy. This is going to be a great challenge. That the rise above the political race will be more issues based. But this is a challenge that we all must face because we are all Malaysians. And I think one thing that is quite significant to me is that for somewhere along the line, we have lost our confidence as Malaysians. There was a time when we felt we could be among the top of the world to compete with the rest of the world in terms of showing what we can do. Malaysia as a model to the world, as a plural society, where the great religions and civilizations have come together. How we can evolve a new society in terms of competitive and progressive. But somewhere along the line, we have lost that competence. As a people, as a nation. Hurtling to become a rogue state, where there's a breakdown of the rule of law, of even a failed state, where because of rampant corruption and abuses of power and the collapse of the of good governance, somewhere along the line, we must rediscover ourselves. And I think and that's important. That's important if in order to bring about this Malaysians together. Undoubtedly, presently, there seems to be a greater emphasis on the politics of race, on the rhetoric of race. But is this just a recrudescence of racial politics? Or could it be that it may be, not completely, a death rattle of politics of race and rhetoric of race? I share Mujahid's optimism that although the prospects are so bleak and dark, there is no cause for total pessimism. I think more and more Malaysians are beginning to realize and to accept that we have a common future that we must together, of all races, of all religions, of all regions, must work in order to build, to make a successful nation. I think so long as you can widen that circle of people among Malaysians, and we continue to encourage Malaysians to go beyond race and religion, then I think the future is not all that bleak. And I think that is something which all political parties must be committed. And we in the Pakatan Harapan, we will do our, that is I think our greatest, would be our greatest challenge, how to arouse and raise among Malaysians this vision, transcending race and religion. And it is something which I think we must reach out. That's why, from the DAP's point of view, we are doing our part. Maybe not enough, but we can do more. But that's why we have embarked on Impian Malaysia, Impian Kelantan, Impian Sabah, Impian Sarawak. Because it is a vehicle and instrument for all Malaysians to see a broader vision, not just confined to their ethnic, religious, or local issues and problems. I think this is a challenging time, and it is something for which for all of us to mull and to think about as how we can rise above our different ethnic selves to reach this national vision. And I think if we can do that, Malaysia will be on a more sounder footing. Thank you very much.
When you as political parties decide how to distribute seat allocations among yourself, I'm very sure that you take racial composition as a factor. Don't you think that means that even your parties are still under the shadow of racial politics? Sunny.
Okay, normally we don't distribute any seats to anyone. We have to beg for seats. But I think taking into awareness the racial thinking, racial sentiments, the racial climate, doesn't mean you're racist. You know, I think it'll be foolish for a party ignores the fact that people think racially. And people do think racially. The way people turn out for Bersih, for example, the way people voted for Pakatan or for BN in the last elections. People then in Malaysia still tend to think in racial, I mean racial groups think differently, they move differently to things. And I think it'd be foolish not to take that into cognizance. And that doesn't mean you're being racist.
Well, I look at it as Malaysian politics has always been communal in nature. Unless and until the constituent, the voters, understand the whole idea about moving forward across racial boundaries, then I think we can achieve such ideal situation where you distribute your seats not based on racial composition, but more on your performance and more on what you can contribute to the society. But I think as a politician, maybe Kit Siang is the most senior here, I'm the most youngest here. I think as a politician, you have this ideal in front of you, but at the same time, you have also to understand the realities. So bridging between ideals and realities, that really make you a good politician. Thank you.
Well, I think race politics is a given, it's a fact which we cannot completely disregard, but we must be able to try to go beyond it. And of course, as one who has been accused down the decades, you're talking about decades, decades in politics, of being anti-Malay and anti-Islam, as a demon, as a monster, being anti-Malay and anti-Islam. I think as far as the DAP is concerned, right from the very first of our 1969 general election, so we have always kept in mind the need to present a multiracial, multireligious slate of candidates in the elections. In fact, in 69, we fielded, we fielded Malay candidates for parliament and state assembly seats. We had two assemblymen, Malay assemblymen elected, one in Perak, one in Negeri Sembilan. And down the decades, we have, it's not easy. It is not easy to, when we continue to be demonized as anti-Malay and anti-Islam, to continue to keep alive this vision. And we have kept this alive, and that's why through the 70s, 80s, 90s, we have had Malay MPs and SAs, and we will continue, because this is our... I don't think we are in politics to turn Malaysia into a Chinese Malaysia, or Indian Malaysia, or Malay Malaysia, or Iban Malaysia, or Kadazan Malaysia. We are all in the boat together. We want to make the best of this nation, and I mean, the question is how we will continue to keep this vision alive. And I agree about the Racial Harmony Act in order to criminalize racial incitement. In fact, I had proposed that we should do away with the race-based parties. And of course, it is not something that does not mean that there's no race-based parties, there'll be no racialism. But it is something that we should move towards to. The vision is there, the objective is there. And I think this must continue to be our governing principles.
That's brilliant. And I think that really sets the context of what's the real situation in Malaysia today. While we have a vision of how to move forward, there is this reality of today that we need to deal with. And that's the point that I wanted to highlight by asking that question, so that we don't keep focusing on the vision and forgetting that there's a reality that we have to deal with today. So with that, let me open to the floor. Dato' Danison first.
Hey, Dato' Mujahid, I see the AMANAH lineup, and is the one Indian and one Chinese in your party exco tokenism or real symbol? Because you're talking of leadership, it's AMANAH, it's hope. And to what extent is there an interface between religion and race there? to YB Michael, I think you have rightly pointed out the issue of the Malay poverty, and those of us working at the ground in the B40 recognize this, not only here but Sabah, Sarawak. Why is it that it is so difficult to build solidarity at the bottom, that people then see the class struggle as opposed to a racial struggle, and to mobilize them in that line? YB Lim, I've sometimes thought I missed my opportunity of being part of DAP, but nonetheless, DAP I know has stood out in many of its outstanding examples to incorporate Malays, especially Indian, within the leadership, and the things you and Guaning have done specifically in this area. But if you look at your party elections, and then a person to win from on a basis of merit and capability, it's almost impossible for Malay or Indian to win in your last party election. So is that a reflection of the party at the base? And what are the ways in which the party would change that to move from just a Kapal family or token examples, but to more genuine participation of others within the party to make it a party? Thank you.
Okay. Satu soalan ialah oleh Saudara Denison berkenaan why can't we build solidarity? I think if you look at the history of the country, I think the parties that were based on the socio-economic linkages of Malaysians, like in the 60s, it was the Socialist Front, you know, I think they were really repressed. They were broken up, they were put in jail, you know, and the unions were broken up. So the politics that were based on socio-economy of workers and peasants alliance between the Pakatan, within the PR, Parti Rakyat at the time, the Labour Party, that group of politicians were really harassed, whereas the government allowed the growth of other parties based on race and religion. So actually it's a policy. It's not because Malaysians are intrinsically ethnic minded, but because the options of going in another direction of, you know, a class-based common rakyats, that was actually stopped. It was, you know, not only stopped, was crushed. So I think you've got to look at the history of that. I don't think it means that Malaysians are naturally more racial conscious than class conscious. I think that doesn't not what history shows us. Daripada apa yang Ismail tanya tadi, ya, berkenaan dengan peruntukan untuk orang asli, ya. Ini bukan saja untuk orang asli, lah. Untuk semua peruntukan untuk pembangunan di kawasan luar bandar atau kawasan, you know, untuk orang miskin. Memang macam itu. Hampir 30, 40, mungkin 50% pun dimakan oleh peringkat-peringkat yang di atas. Daripada DO, ADUN, MP, dan juga kontraktor, dia tak sampai kepada sasaran. Walaupun ada peruntukan, bukan semuanya sampai. Jika sampai pun, mungkin kualiti dewan ke, kualiti rumah ke apa pun, tak sampai ke tahap yang dispesifikasikan dalam kontrak. Dan saya cara kita nak mengatasi ini, ya, kita kena memperkasakan rakyat. Kita mesti membolehkan rakyat untuk memantau. So kita kena minta semua peruntukan untuk pembangunan di peringkat desa ini, kita mesti pamerkan dalam website. Kita mesti bagi tahu, jika nak buat rumah, rumah macam mana? Nak pakai batu macam mana? Nak pakai foundation macam mana? Nak pakai bumbung macam mana? Apakah kontrak yang dikeluarkan? So kampung itu tahu, oh, saya diberikan 10 rumah dengan harga RM30,000 serumah dengan spesifikasi macam ini. Mereka boleh memantau. Kerana jika itu kontraktor bagi yang kurang daripada itu, dia tipu orang kampung. So kita kena memperkasakan kampung. Mungkinlah kita nak beli senjata, kita tak boleh bagi open lah spesifikasi. Tapi untuk buat rumah, untuk buat sekolah, untuk buat klinik, untuk buat jalan di kawasan desa, kenapa tak boleh bagi tahu? Ini bukan secret yang musuh Malaysia akan dapat tahu, kan? So I rasa kita kena empower, memperkasakan rakyat kita untuk mengetahui what is being given to them. And that's the only way I think we can make sure duit yang di yang di yang diperuntukkan sampai ke sasaran. Karena jika orang kampung tahu, you kena pakai macam ini, kena buat macam ini, dan dibuat kurang daripada itu, dia akan marah. Dia cakap, kenapa dia tipu saya? Betul tak? Kita minta SPRM ke kementerian tengok, bukan dia bayar sikit lagi, dia diam. So I think the best thing is, let the people be transparent, bagi mereka tahu, mereka mantau, and they can complain. Lepas dia.
Ini ikut giliran ya. Okay, saya rasa kebanyakan soalan itu ditujukan kepada Saudara Lim Kit Siang. Cuma saya ingin respon pada Profesor, sahabat saya, Profesor Darison. We've been quite a long comrade in the NUCC, and our term has end, my term has end actually. This is the same question. Amanah line up. Amanah number one, open the door for any Malaysian, regardless of their faith and ethnic background, to join the party. So itu satu yang membezakan kami dengan my former party, PAS. Now the fact that you do not see the lineup there doesn't mean that we do not want Chinese or Indian or even from Sabah and Sarawak to be in the lineup. The problem is that some of them no support us, but few of them wants to be in the leadership. So what we are doing today, number one, you should understand the party is only 1 month and a half. Half old. Sebulan setengah saja umur kami. So what we are doing now is more recruitment, going to the various communities to join the party in as long as they believe the struggle of the principle of the party. And I think by doing that, we hope to get more Chinese, we hope to get more Indians and even Sabah and Sarawak to join us, as Parti Amanah is a non-racial party that opens the door for any Malaysian to join the party. Orang asli juga, orang asal juga digalakkan. Kalau mungkin ada satu masa, saya boleh bagi penerangan dan penjelasan serta taklimat Parti Amanah, dan saya boleh bawa orang banyak-banyak. So, itu satu. Thank you for that question. Yang kedua ialah mungkin saya respon sikit kepada Hajah Ainun, my sister. Saya boleh merasainya sebab bab ayah saya, Haji Yusof Rawa, bekas Presiden PAS. Sometimes saya nak bagi tahu macam mana ya. It's the DNA lah. Okay? It's the DNA, you know, because you live with it. But out of the 11th children of Haji Yusof Rawa, only two joined politics, myself and my sister. And when Amanah came in, both of us joined Amanah. So what I'm trying to say is that there are things that we cannot, say that just because you are Haji Yusof Rawa's son, you cannot get involved in politics. But the best way to do it is to go step by step from bottom up, so that dia boleh mengetahui selok belok perjuangan itu. Cuma saya tidak berapa setuju hanya kerana dia itu dari keturunan pemimpin-pemimpin tertentu, maka dia tidak boleh terlibat dalam politik. Yang saya setuju ialah penglibatannya mesti juga di atas merit, mana kemampuan dia. Dan saya ingat kata-kata pujangga Arab di zaman jahiliyah, ketika orang memuji-muji bapa dia, lalu dengan itu dia mau diletakkan di tempat yang tinggi, maka dia berkata, laisal fata man yaqulu kana abi walakinnal fata man yaqulu ha ana dha. Everyone understand Arabic? Seorang perwira itu tidak menyatakan dulunya bapa aku begini. Tapi seorang perwira itu menyatakan, lihatlah kepada aku. So I think if everyone can understand that without menumpang dia punya career politik itu atas nama bapaknya, maka saya kira itu tidak ada salahnya. Yang salah ialah menumpang dan menggunakan walaupun dia tidak layak. Dan sebab itu saya yakin mana-mana parti politik ada dia punya sistem rekrutmen dia. Dan kami daripada Amanah dalam masa terdekat ini akan mengumumkan sistem rekrutmen kita, di mana siapa sahaja yang memasuki Amanah ada peluang dia untuk menjadi pemimpin di masa hadapan setelah dia melalui proses rekrutmen kita, sehingga kita dapat melahirkan successive leadership tak kira siapa mereka, daripada orang kampung biasa ataupun orang yang elitis. Jikalau mereka mengikuti step-step ini, maka layak mereka untuk menjadi pemimpin, dan terpulang kepada ahli sama ada bersetuju untuk melantik dia atau tidak dalam pemilihan parti yang lebih demokratik. So ini adalah way forward untuk kita menghindari daripada hanya melihat potensi itu di kalangan yang terdekat. Bagi saudara Ismail, saya juga ingin merespon di sini tentang apa yang dibuat oleh ahli parlimen Pakatan Harapan. Untuk pengetahuan, sekarang ini perbahasan di peringkat dasar sedang berjalan, berbaki lagi mungkin seminggu dua. Maka saya kira sepanjang yang saya dengar perbahasan ahli-ahli parlimen Pakatan Harapan banyak menyebut tentang keterisan yang berlaku serta polisi-polisi yang tidak memberi kebaikan kepada rakyat jelata. Dan saya kira tidak ada mana-mana ahli parlimen Pakatan Harapan yang berucap, melainkan salah satu daripada rukun ucapan mereka ialah bertanyakan tentang 1MDB dan juga di mana 2.6 bilion. Malah kita menyatakan selagi 1MDB dan 2.6 bilion itu tidak dijawab dengan yakin, kami sukar untuk menerima bajet 2016 ini. So itu saya kira cukup jelas message kita kepada orang ramai, mewakili bukan kita tapi mewakili kehendak orang di bawah yang bertanya, bukan kami yang bertanya tapi orang bawah yang bertanya. So itu respon saya sikit, dan dengan itu saya serahkan.
We want every Malaysian to pull your weight, and that's why whether in the not only in, I don't agree that the Malays and the Indians can make their mark in the party elections. There were some today you can see the reply from the Home Minister that they're still studying, that they're still probing into the DAP's party elections in the 2012 or 2013. And I think this probably makes history as the longest probe by the Registrar of Societies on a political party on a matter which has nothing for the Registrar of Societies actually to investigate. It was a genuine mistake, and although they instructed us to have a re-election, and there's no reason for re-election, and we decided, well, we go ahead because we have nothing to hide. And despite the re-election, the complaints were made, and these are, we know, are people who were put up by the parties concerned, people from UMNO, and in particular from MIC, because they have nothing else to do at the time. And they created lots of complaints, and we are still subject to such investigations. But whatever it is, as far as you are concerned, we do not want to have any tokens. We want to have everyone to pull their weight. And that's why Kuala, Rama, Ghana, and they all have an important role to play at all levels of party leadership, and Zairil, and Arif, and Rara, and Diana. We are becoming more inclusive, more open, and we hope in the next few years we will be able to emerge, to be able to represent and to be seen as a more multiracial, because more Malaysian, and that goes for Sabah and Sarawak as well. That was why we have this very hacking programs in Sabah, in Sarawak, even in Kelantan, our various impian state projects, and this is something which we are reaching out, and we hope that this will be something which we will be able to show an example how all political parties must mature to become more Malaysian in approach. On the second question, I want to stress, as far as we are concerned, We don't believe in any so-called hereditary politics, because I don't think there is something that is in our definition. I know that it's always Guan Eng has always been mentioned, but let me say that Guan Eng has followed me into the under the Internal Security Act. Actually, it's only 2 days ago was the 28th anniversary of Operation Malang. And when in 1987, when there was this dragnet of mass arrest under the Operation Malang, myself and Guan Eng, we were also made the guests of His Majesty's government. And at that time, Guan Eng was just elected as a member of parliament. Subsequently, he graduated and went to Kajang prison in defending underage girl, which I didn't have as yet an opportunity to be sent to prison. I've been twice into the Security Act, but these are not something we want to be able to pass for our children to inherit, to go to prison, to go to jail. But these are things which those who believe in justice, in the cause of a better society, must be prepared to face, to undergo. And that's why I'm telling Jasuria, you're welcome, you must be prepared for such trials and tribulations. On Ismail, I want to say that, Saudara Ismail, that as Mujahid has mentioned, as far as Pakatan Harapan is concerned, we want to ensure that the budget of the country, the people's money, are used for the people's good, not siphoned and hijacked by breach of trust, misuse of power, and of course the best example is 1MDB scandal. Up to now, there is evasion and avoidance, giving a full accountability of the 1MDB scandal, which has become the biggest scandal in the history of the nation. And it was seeing almost a daily development, daily exposure of this 1MDB. And if we cannot get the Prime Minister and the government to give accountability, you can understand how difficult it is to ensure that the government lives up to its commitment to become transparent, to be accountable, to principles of good governance. In fact, 1MDB is a good example. Even the Malay rulers have come up with the most unprecedented statement on the October the 6th, expressing their concern about the 1MDB. And I don't think there's any scandal in the country which has been also the subject of investigations by other countries. Up to now, if I'm not mistaken, there are at least 8 countries which have opened separate investigations into 1MDB. And as far as MPs are concerned, we are still completely in the dark about 1MDB. There is a total a procrastination in making an accountability. And the reason why I'm now a bit freer is because I have objected to the Speaker using his powers, and I said he doesn't have the powers, in order to delay the Public Accounts Committee from continuing investigations into the 1MDB. And that shows that when you have a Deputy Prime Minister being sacked, a full minister being sacked, an Attorney General being sacked, the so-called special task force into the 1MDB suddenly being dissolved, and many people being arrested, being charged in court under Section 124 of the Penal Code, allegedly for being conspirators in a plot, an international plot, in carrying out activities detrimental to parliamentary democracy. I mean, there's a indication how uphill it is going to be. But maybe there is no way, except if you are going to ensure accountability and good governance principles being accepted, there is no other way except for a change of government. A change of government, and that is why it is important that we see the larger and the greater picture on this matter.